often told to turn off our inner critic and just go with something. Trust our intuition. Trust our creative ideas. But meditation doesn't work that way. You have to have an inner critic. The issue is how to train the inner critic to be a good critic rather than simply a destructive one or a lazy one or an inattentive one or an intermittent one. It comes down to that old issue of the difference between being judgmental and being judicious. You want to have a very judicious inner critic to look at how things are going in the practice so you can develop a sense of balance. Learning how to develop that balance is probably one of the most important skills you have to develop as a meditator, and it's one of the more difficult ones. If you're riding a bicycle, it's easy to tell when you have your balance and when you've lost your balance. Working with the mind, it's more difficult, because the mind is a much more complex phenomenon. Another way of thinking about it is that we're learning a skill here that we're not necessarily good at. And many of us have never really had to learn those skills. And as a result, we don't know how to learn to do something we're not yet good at. And so it takes extra amount of being observant, an extra willingness to make mistakes in order to develop that sense of how to learn. The Buddha lists four qualities that are important for learning, which are important for any skill: desire, persistence, intent, and term wubangsa, which is difficult to translate. It can mean ingenuity, it can mean circumspection. Sort of the active, analytical side of the mind. And in each case, the Buddha said it's important that you learn how to balance these qualities. Know when there's too much desire, too little desire. Too much effort, too little effort. Being too focused, not being focused enough. Being too analytical and not analytical enough. And unfortunately, he doesn't give us any clear guidelines, because that's something we have to learn for ourselves. And to learn, we have to be willing to make mistakes. We can't simply come and ask for simple 3 or 4 word formula that'll take us through any situation. Think of any skill that you've learned. It always requires a sense of balance. When you're cooking, how much salt is too much salt? How much salt is too little salt? How much heat is too much? How much heat is too little? How do you learn these things? You can read in the cookbooks, but that doesn't really teach you. You have to learn to look for the signs. Same with music. How much practice is too much practice? How much practice is too little practice? You have to learn to look for the signs. And all too often, there's no book to tell you. It's even more so when we come to the meditation. Desire. We all want to get results. We all want to be good meditators. But exactly how much desire is appropriate for us at our current level of skill, our current level of ability? How much persistence is appropriate for us? Sometimes we read really stirring Dharma talks, really stirring books. We want to go out there and devote ourselves 24/7 to the meditation. And after a while, we find that it begins to get dry. You can't go simply on effort or desire alone. You have to learn how to gauge your effort, what you're capable of. And at the same time, not be too willing to slide back and let yourself off too easy. How much is too easy? How much is too hard? That you have to learn for yourself. It's like developing proper pitch. You have to develop your ear. Look for the signs when things start getting frazzled. it seems that distracting thoughts are just too easily coming in. Those are signs of too much, too little effort, too much, too little persistence. But each of us has his or her own signs, so we have to watch for them, which means giving time to the meditation. And learning how to balance your desire for results with a realistic appraisal of where your abilities are right now. And also how to deal with the mind that wants results too fast. To deal with the mind that tends to throw itself into things and then burn out. You have to learn how to pace yourself. What this means is when you find that the meditation is beginning to get dry, you've been putting too much effort into it, you can learn how to relax without totally abandoning the practice. Something they call recovery mode. In any skill, there come periods when you can just push, 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 and you're really getting results, and then after a while, for some reason, the rhythm has to change. You've reached as far as you can really push yourself at that point, so you back up a little bit, but you don't totally abandon what you're doing. You try to maintain that inner sense of the observer, the inner sense of mindfulness. Go do something else, but make it part of the practice of mindfulness. There are always plenty of chores to be done around the monastery. There's no end to them. We could be working in the chores all day long, every day. Still not get them done. So there's always something to do. And as long as it's meritorious, as long as it's good for the mind, you're developing good qualities in the mind, it's a fine thing to do. Just try to stay mindful. Try to keep that stance inside, the stance of watching. In other words, when the mind gets so tied up and being tied to the practice, it's beginning to feel constricted, give it some freedom. Give it some choices. Make sure they're all good choices. But simply that sense of having a choice of what to do, many times you find you want to choose to go back to meditate without feeling constricted. This principle works on an inner level as well. Kind of concentration that gets really fixated on one point to the exclusion of everything else in the body. That sometimes is a useful practice, but not consistently, not always. You also need times when there's a more broadened awareness of the body, which gives you a greater sense of freedom, so the breath doesn't feel so constricted, so the mind doesn't feel so worn out by a particular technique. So you have to learn to get a sense of the mind's rhythms, what it needs now, and learn how to give it choices so it doesn't feel confined in the practice. Look at all the different meditation themes that the Buddha teaches. If you get tired of the breath, there are other things you can think about, other things you can focus on. Learn how to play with the meditation. It's not all work. And remember how much can be learned by playing. How many great guitarists that have come from simply somebody fooling around on a guitar for a while. Not necessarily doing what they're supposed to do, but still with the guitar. Playing this, playing that, trying this, trying that, and something new comes out of it. Have that same element of play in your meditation. It's something to be enjoyed. John Fuang once said that meditation without rapture is like a machine without a lubricant. The parts grind against each other, the friction builds up, the heat builds up. And after a while, the whole thing seizes up. There's got to be that sense of lubrication. There's got to be that sense of ease and well-being. Simply make sure that the ease and well-being is in the Dharma. Is in the mindfulness, is in the concentration. So what it comes down to is those principles that Ajahn Phuong used to stress so much. Be observant. Use your imagination. Play with the meditation. Learn to develop a judicious critic inside. Or if you want to think of training the mind as like training a child, learn to develop a wise parent inside. When the mind starts getting obstreperous and recalcitrant, ask yourself, what would a wise parent do in this case? And the voice of that wise parent, the decisions of that wise parent, those become your teacher. That becomes your judicious inner critic. The one that instead of getting in the way of the meditation or destroying the meditation, really helps the process along. If you have a critic that sees you make a mistake and say, you're hopeless. That's not a critic. That's not a useful critic at all. That's not a useful observation. We're not here to pass judgment on ourselves or to deal in recriminations, just to simply notice, well, that didn't go very well. Let's try something else. Or that did go well. Let's see how long we can keep it going. See how we can make it better. And be careful not to push it too hard and not to push it too little. Again, you're going to push it too hard and push it too little. It's ordinary, normal. John Munn once said that in teaching the middle way, it's normal that we're going to go on either side of the middle way for quite a while, swinging back and forth, back and forth. But as you learn from the back and forth swings, that's what puts you on the middle path. So expect that you're going to make mistakes, but also have the attitude that allows you to pick yourself up, dust yourself off, and get back to work. Learn from your mistakes. And over time, that inner parent becomes more and more wise. The inner critic becomes more and more judicious. May not be absolutely wise or judicious to begin with, but it heads in that direction. This is how valuable things develop. They take time. Not simply time, they take being observant as well.